In the previous movie, we added some custom attributes to better control our human, and then used him as a base to create our zombie. In this movie, we'll populate the entire graveyard with humans and zombies. Open the file Zombie Apocalypse Part 3 Start. To start, let's duplicate some more humans and zombies using the Duplicate Specials shortcut Ctrl-Shift-D. When you play the scene, you'll see that while they're rotating, they aren't translating. If you recall from the previous movie, we had to individually add the zombie to our move expression. Does that really mean we'll have to add a new move command for every duplicate we create? What if we created a scene with 200 characters? Ideally, we'd want Maya to add each character to the move command for us. Luckily, we can actually do this. Open the expression editor and select the move expression. First, we'll need to make a list of all the characters in our scene and store it somewhere. For this, we will use a variable. Think of a variable like a box, a temporary storage space for a value, similar to an attribute, but that only exists in the script itself. Add the following line. Let's break down this line. String indicates the type of variable we're storing here, similar to the float we used in the previous movie. Since we want a list of our character names, string is a keyword Maya uses to indicate we'll be storing text. Objects is the name of our variable. The dollar sign is a key symbol that lets Maya know that the word following it refers to a variable. The name of the variable is technically arbitrary. We could have just as easily called it dollar banana, but it is good scripting practice to make the names meaningful. The square brackets indicate this particular variable is an array. An array allows us to store multiple values as indexes under one variable name. Each index will be one object in our scene. Now notice the tilde sign. If you remember from the previous movie, a pair of tilde signs indicate a Maya command is between them. In this case, we're using the ls or list command, and we specify we want to list every object starting with the word human or zombie. To ensure we include every numbered human and zombie, we insert an asterisk at the end, which tells Maya to grab every object with either name plus anything appended to the end. Finally, we add the TR flag to indicate we only want the transform node. We don't want to perform our script on the shape node or cache node by accident. Now that we have a list of all the humans and zombies stored somewhere, we need a way to go through this list and move them one by one. Luckily, we can do just that with a loop. A loop is a scripting structure that repeats itself until some sort of condition is fulfilled. Start with the following structure. This essentially says, for each object A in the array of objects, do whatever is between those two curly brackets. So if we return to our box analogy, think of the variable $A as a table where we put each index in $objects as we are examining it. Now that we have a looping structure, we just need to actually execute the move command. Enter the following line between the brackets. Notice this is almost exactly like our move expression for a single human or zombie. We replaced any reference to a specific human or zombie object with our $A variable. This way, when our $A table is holding a human, this expression will move a human. Likewise, when our $A table is holding a zombie, it will move a zombie. Also notice that we've indented the commands within this loop. This isn't necessary, but makes the script much easier to read. Remove the old move commands and click the edit button. Now try playing the scene. We're still getting an error, but why? Scripting errors will always appear in the script editor. According to this, Maya is attempting to access a speed attribute on our human mesh. However, if you remember, we only made a speed attribute for our group nodes, not the actual meshes. This is happening because the asterisk we used when building our list of objects is grabbing anything starting with the word human or zombie, including our meshes. We need to make sure the meshes don't get put into this list, so let's append something before the word human and zombie. In the outliner, add the word original underscore. Now try to play the scene again. Notice that they all move properly now. While loops have saved us from having to create individual move commands for each character, it's still pretty time-consuming to keep duplicating and moving them. Luckily, we can use the power of loops to save the day again. Save your work and open the script editor. Why are we using the script editor this time when we used the expression editor before? Unlike the expressions we've created, we don't want this script to run continuously, otherwise it will keep generating new humans and zombies on every frame. This time, we want to create a script that we can run manually to set up our scene once. First, enter the following line. This creates an integer variable that will represent the number of humans in our scene. In this case, 10. Now let's set up our looping structure. Enter the following line. You'll notice this is a little different from the looping structure we used before. This is called a counting loop. Basically, this says that for a counter, $i, that starts at 0, repeat what's in the brackets as long as $i is less than the number of humans in the scene. The $i++ at the end increments the counter for us each time the loop is run. In this specific case, it means the loop will repeat 10 times. Now inside the loop, add the following line. Basically, this creates a new human, which will be called human group pound, where Maya automatically replaces the pound with a number by duplicating the old human. Without getting into specifics, the flags are used to mimic the duplicate special options we introduced in the previous movie. Finally, add the following lines. The first line is mainly housekeeping. We must set our new human's visibility attribute so that we can actually see it, since duplicates are always hidden by default. In the next two lines, we create a random X and Z value using the rand function. Notice that the numbers ensure our new human will appear within the boundaries of our scene. Finally, we use the move command to move our new human to a random spot denoted by those two variables. When we reach the bottom curly bracket, we loop back to the top of the expression, increment the $i counter, and start again. To test this, delete any existing human duplicates, then highlight the entire script in the script editor, and click the blue execute button at the top. You can also press Control Enter. 10 humans are randomly littered around our scene. Now delete all the duplicates and repeat the script for the zombies, using the current one as a reference. Now you can see that humans and zombies are both littered across the scene. As a final bit of housekeeping, it's rather strange that the humans and zombies appear in a mishmash together. Let's have them start on opposite ends of the graveyard. Alter the rand expression so that the humans can only appear in the positive x, positive z quadrant, while zombies only in the negative x, negative z quadrant. If you run the script one more time, you'll see that, besides the original human and zombie, all the duplicates start off separated from each other. Now instead of continuously duplicating and repositioning humans and zombies manually, we can just change the $numHumans and $numZombies values in our initialization script. We'll definitely want to save this script for later. Let's call it Zombie Apocalypse Initialize. In the next movie, we'll learn what vectors are and use them to make the humans and zombies actually interact with each other.